Got a Century motor here that I have not tested out yet. It was a spare provided with the M52 Frigidaire refrigerator I restored from 1926. Has a tag on it. Says motor hums only. So we're going to see if we can get to the bottom of that. Figure out what's going on with it. It is a dual voltage motor with the four leads. Repulsion, start, induction. A quarter horsepower. So the first thing I want to do is get the meter. And I'm going to just do a couple of brief sanity checks, so to speak. It should have two separate windings, so I'll go get that where it's better viewable. From the bottom wire to the second one from the top, I'm going to obviously have to strip that one back again. Yeah, I'm not getting any good contact there. Much as I hate to cut back any vintage wire, sometimes the situation just gets where you have to. Okay, we got about 5.2 ohms there. And go to the next pair here. 3 ohms. Let's see, that doesn't add up. Those should be equal. So unless I've this wire needs to be cleaned more, that's a bad sign. But we're going to continue anyway. The next check, I'm going to go from metal here and check for any obviously grounded out windings. That looks good. It means that I don't have to worry about a ground fault when I try to run it. So I'm going to clean up these wires a little bit and try to get better connectivity there. And I'm going to do that off camera to save time, and then we'll come back and continue with the troubleshooting. Okay, so I took a little bit of Scotch-Brite and spread all the strands of the wire out and kept rubbing them with that with some light oil till I got them clean. And that made a little better of a reading. 3.0 ohms on one winding. 3.0, 3.1 on the other. So that looks good. I think that we're not looking at a motor with a burned winding at this point. So the way it was connected together initially was those top two wires were tied together, the bottom two were tied together. So I'm going to set up a test cord with some alligator clips on it where we can clip them on there. It won't have to twist those wires up again and again and risk breaking more and more of the strands off. The black hot side of the cord, I got two clips. So to signify these two tied together like they were to start with, I'm going to clip both of them to the black. And the same goes for the neutral side. The bottom two lines were tied together. So I'm going to hook them up like that. And that is the way this motor was wired. And then I have a switch box over here. And off screen, I have a kilowatt meter where I can see the amps it's drawing. So I'm going to plug this in and we'll see what happens. So here goes nothing. All right, it is pulling 2.2 amps. Which is hardly anything. So this time I'm going to do it again and try to turn the shaft manually. Oh. Every now and then the brushes hit a spot and it kicks a little bit like it wants to run. So what I think is happening, I think there's some kind of a coating in there, a non-conductive coating. It's built up. So I'm going to unplug it from the switch box and turn it around, and we'll take the back cover of it off and have a little inspection of what's going on in there. So one thing about a repulsion start motor versus what we're all used to now, which would be just a regular induction motor, If this motor is not starting like that because the brushes aren't making contact, it actually doesn't draw hardly any current. You can think of the stator winding as a transformer primary with power being injected, and the rotor winding is a transformer secondary. And if that circuit on the secondary is closed through the brushes or through the shorting necklace, then the high current flowing in the secondary or in the rotor will make the primary or the stator draw a lot of amps. And since a regular induction motor, the rotor part always has closed circuits, if that motor can't spin up, it's going to draw a tremendous amount of current. But with the repulsion induction, you can tell that this one humming softly like that and only drawing 2 amps, that the rotor side of it didn't have a good contact. And, you know, being that it wasn't running and there's no airflow like that, it would have eventually gotten hot if I let it just sit there. But it's not, you know, like an emergency for the motor like it would be for a regular motor to have it do that. And as you can see, you know, I could turn the shaft and occasionally get a little catch and it would try to move, but nothing too spectacular. Try to stay on camera here. There we go. Take these wires off. I don't want to break off those leads any shorter. I don't know what that is coming out right there. Looks like a leaf. There's no telling. Oh. Not a whole lot of brush left. That could be the problem. But let me go look through the junk box. So I have a kit of motor brushes that I received from another collector. And it probably has these brushes in there. Yeah, these have some kind of gum on them that's probably not right. So it's a wedge cross section. About like that. But you look at that, it's not worn at all. It's the same exact length as a fresh one. And seeing as how, you know, these parts are obsolete now, and I have some new ones there, but I don't want to waste them if I don't have to. So I'm going to keep the originals. And something was keeping them from making contact. So we know they're the same length as a new one, so we can eliminate wear out of the brushes as being part of the problem. Now the Delco motors like this, they have a wire bridge between the two brushes, two pairs of brushes, to help them always have a complete circuit. I know that Century doesn't have that, so if this has gum or grease on it, where it's not making contact inside the brush holder, you're gonna probably see a problem like this. Oh, I'm off screen again, darn it. So I've got a piece of Scotch-Brite here with some brake cleaner on it. I'm just lightly rubbing the brush down with it. Try to get it down to that plated area. I want the carbon to be bare, not covered in grease and grime. A clean place to put that. And I'm not trying to grind it down. I'm just trying to get the gum off of it so it's going to slide freely in the mechanism. Once these are cleaned up, I'll clean the commutator up. Make them shiny again. I was talking to somebody here on, you know, in real life, friend, a couple days ago about how, you know, you don't want to send one of these motors to a motor shop that you don't, that you know doesn't have the skills to work on them, because the parts are so obsolete. If they start breaking and wasting and ruining parts, you might go from a minor problem to a problem that is unfixable. Because again, every part of this motor is, you know, nearly 100 years old, and you're just not going to get spares. Go down the road and get spares like you can for a modern motor. If I, you know, go and work on a motor made in the 70s or 80s, which is kind of vintage by today's standards, and let's say I'm careless and I drop the start capacitor on the floor and it breaks up because it's a Bakelite, well, I can go down to the HVAC supply and get another one in 10 minutes. But any part of this motor gets broken, you're going to have to either fabricate it or find another motor. So the brushes slide down in this slot, and that's all full of gum. So I'm going to use more brake cleaner on it. But what I don't want to do is get the bearing all full of brake cleaner. So I'm going to make a little paper wad and put in there. Yeah, that will help to kind of block some of that from going on the bearing. And I'm just going to use just enough, you know, to kind of damp everything up. And then take the Scotch-Brite, go down in there, again, try to do the same thing. Need a little something more aggressive than that. I got a brass bristle brush here. That might be a little too much. Maybe a nylon brush. Want to eliminate that gummy texture that's down in there. Because as you saw, we had basically an open circuit in the rotor part of the system, and that circuit needs to complete through the brushes for startup on a repulsion start motor. And it can't do it if either the brushes don't slide down and touch the commutator, or if the brushes are covered in something non-conductive. It's keeping the circuit from being complete. So off camera, I'm going to give that an air blowing, and we'll see if the brushes slide more freely. Okay, everything's cleaned up. The next thing I want to do is lubricate this brush lifting mechanism, since I dried it out with that cleaner. So I'm going to use this chain and cable lube. What it is, it's a penetrating lubricant that once it penetrates in there, the solvent part of it will evaporate, leave behind a nice tacky oil that will stay in place. So I'm just going to try to carefully, without putting too much on the system, just get those little pivot points, like so. That way the mechanism will have the least amount of force on it, because everything moves freely. Rather than make it have to work too hard and wear itself out. That one's pretty stuck. I'm going to have to work on that one a little more. That's much better. Make sure all of them move freely like that. Okay, can't complain about that functionality. Now I got overzealous with the chain and cable lube, so I gotta do a little more spot cleanup. Now let's see if the brushes are gonna work properly now. There's no position I can put that in where it sticks. It's always free to move. Thank you. I like that one. Also moves nicely. Oop, copper side down. Okay, so all four of those work like they're supposed to. Now the other part of this equation is the commutator. And you can tell by looking at that, I mean, it honestly, it feels like someone's almost put cosmoline on that. But I know that wouldn't have been done. I think it's probably just oil over the years that seeped onto the commutator and dried up. Kind of turned to varnish and gum. So I'm going to rub that down first with just a rag and brake cleaner. Oh yeah, look at that. So the next concern will be whether the short circuiting necklace part down inside there is going to work. But again, I want to just do the minimum at this point with this motor to try and make it work again. See if we can troubleshoot what was actually the reason that it was tagged as not working. I know some of the purists may gag and choke seeing me use Scotch-Brite on here, but it does a good job and it won't hurt anything. One thing that concerns me, there's a little bit of fretting right there. It looks like it may have sat with the power on and the motor not running a long time or something. I don't know really, but that little area right there looks a little bit abnormally worn. So get the meter back. Get it on camera, but not in my way. Prop it up. So first thing I'm going to do is check from the shaft. We have mega ohms, which I'm okay with that. The rotor is an isolated circuit anyway. So far, all of them have continuity. That startup you just heard was another motor exactly like this one. That's the sound we hope to get from this one. It's cool in here right now. In that single cylinder frigid air compressor, it doesn't really seem to be as quiet in cold weather. I don't know if it's the condenser pressure is too low or what, but when it warms up, you hear a lot less of that tapping. The way it sounds right now is the way it would sound even at startup. Well, now it's loud again. It's just almost warm enough for it. Okay, no open segments on the commutator. That's always a plus. So now, this part is what actually pushes the brushes back. And it's a moving part, so I'm gonna put a little bit more of this cable lube in there. just a bare enough, minimum enough to lubricate it. Because again, I'm trying to avoid the commutator itself getting oiled up. Get the extra off of there. So if this repair didn't fix it, then the next thing we'll do is take the rotor out all the way and see if the shorting necklace is not working properly. So this is not a ring oiled motor. It has oil felt in there, packing. You might be able to see. So if this end housing doesn't slide on freely, I'll have to take that packing out. But there, it went on freely. The packing is probably a little bit tired and not sticking out very far. But one thing I noticed putting this end housing on, the brushes don't seem to really reach the commutator like they should. And they're fully extended. I'll have to see how that goes when it's pushed together all the way. Because this end bell does pilot onto the motor body a little deeper than I remembered, so I think we may be okay. When you're dealing with these things that are so old, you just don't know how many times it's been apart before, who's worked on it. You just don't know what's been done. So you can't take for granted that this rotor and this housing came together and that they're really both parts of the same model motor. Someone could have put something together with parts that aren't compatible. And, you know, it looked great, but it didn't work. Still got a lot more in play than I wish it did, but again, if I was doing a real restoration on this motor, I would do a lot more things to it. But I'm just trying to go over the basic troubleshooting steps that I would use to determine if it's good or you know, why it's not working. And I don't want to confuse this troubleshooting video with a lot of extra information. All right, you can hear that sounds nice and dry in there where it's rubbing. So let's get the test cord back out. Hook it up the way they had it. The two top ones are one circuit. Two bottom ones are the other circuit. So here we go again. You hear that funny noise it made? That makes me think the shorting necklace didn't make contact at first. Go for another start. So we're better off, but it's still... it sounds pretty unhealthy. So we're going to take it back apart again. It shouldn't go through that neutral point between starting and running that you hear. But the gummed up brushes and commutator was the reason that it couldn't start. One thing that I would be interested to know is how much voltage potential the commutator has on it when the brushes are not making contact. You know what I mean? So in other words, how much voltage potential would be available to let's say arc through the dirt film. And I think we can probably find that out pretty easily. So I'm going to mark the commutator segments where the brushes are riding right now. At least two of them. And then when the motor's apart, I'm going to actually hook power back up to it, and I'm going to measure with the meter on those points and see what kind of voltage the rotor winding produces. Because I'm curious about that, and I honestly have no idea what to expect. Although I would expect it wouldn't be a very high voltage. So those two points that are marked had have the brushes touching them. And if I don't get anything there, I guess I could mark the other two points too. I'm going to go ahead and count out and mark the other points. Okay, those four marks are where the brushes were riding with the end housing on. I'm going to go back to AC voltage mode. This is probably going to make a really loud buzzing noise without the bearing. So we had 31 volts that the brushes would have to short out there. Interestingly, in spite of that vibration, looking at the kilowatt meter, that was only drawing 2 amps. So that would mean any kind of a gum film or an oil film on there, if it can resist a 32 volt potential, it's going to prevent this motor from working. See if I can get this out without taking the front. The rotor is really heavy. And I don't want to hit this on the winding, but it's deceptive because you'll think that the rotor is incredibly heavy, but really you're lifting up on it and dragging it, and then when you slide off the end, you'll go up and hit the top. So it's tricky. Yeah, that motor really needs a cleaning. But again, for the purposes of this troubleshooting video, I'm not going to spend time on that. As much as it goes against my upbringing. Make sure there's nothing that's going to fall out and go down into the abyss underneath the bench. Have to adjust the camera. So this is a lock pin or lock deal in here that I can take out. This part right here, there goes the air compressor. That's the spanner nut. If it's stuck, you can take a pair of snap ring pliers and get in there to turn it and get it off. Okay, I'm gonna keep everything in order. That came out, the spring was in it. Then this part with that bearing that pushes into the brushes went on top of that. And there's the shorting necklace. And you can see how it's green and corroded. Down inside there is also green and corroded. So that is going to be our problem with that that vibrating and neutral point it had between starting and running. So I'm going to go do some parts cleanup. Now, you could just take something and rub down in there and clean that up, but I'm going to cheat and use the resources I have available here to do it more quickly. But all you need is a Scotch-Brite to go in there and clean it up. I'm going to go do it on the lathe. Now, there's two push rods inside here. Those two pins. And those work based on the fly weights at the front. And I know I've worked on other motors before where those would fall out. But I think on this one, they're retained in there where they can't. But centrifugal force, separating that out, is what actually operates the mechanism in the motor to go from start to run mode. And it operates those two push rods in there. And again, I'm one of those guys, I work on a whole bunch of different motors, maybe only one of each type per year, so no one can remember it all. And I would rather mention those pins and then have them not be free in this model motor than not say anything and have them fall out on the floor of yours and get lost. And through the magic of video, it's all clean. So I cleaned inside there where the short-circuiting necklace makes contact. And then I lubricated the flyweight mechanism with the same oil that I was talking about earlier, the chain and cable lube. Now it's time to put it back together. So this has one side that has two little raised ends on it. That's supposed to be the outside. So like that. And then this goes around this cupped piece here. And it's fiddly, and I'm going to look like a clumsy idiot doing it on camera, but it's not that hard when you're doing it without a camera in between you and the workpiece. And that spring holds it in. I can feel there's just a little bit of tension on it from the spring, which is what I want. But what I'm going to do, I'm going to take some of this silicone grease and just a little bit of it now. Just a tiny little bit of it. I'm going to wipe it inside there all the way around. And what that's going to do is help to prevent corrosion from setting up in there again. Because that's what got it. It had a lot of green, kind of green corrosion in there. So now, but again, this was, well, the memory card filled up while I was putting the silicone grease in there. So this had a lot of heavy green corrosion in it. And I'm sure that came from sulfur dioxide because this motor was driving a sulfur dioxide compressor. And over the years, you know, that would have leaked and corroded it. So I'm going to go ahead and put this in. I've ensured that the step side with the two raised ends is out. And squeeze it together and put it in. Feel that little resistance. Come back with the spring and the spanner nut. I remember there were about three threads of the shaft showing, three full threads. Right, like about that when it went in there, or when I took it apart. So I'll run it back down to that same position and put the locking clip in. And that should be the rotor. That's how it's supposed to work. So I'm going to take the clean side of this paper towel, clean the journal where it rides in that front bearing on the housing, give it a little bit of extra oil up there because I like that, you know, it makes me feel better about everything. Knowing it's not going to have to start up and ride dry, so to speak. Go in there with it like that. Trying to avoid gouging the winding. Get this back on screen. So that's getting closer to going back together. Now I've got another little bit of brake cleaner on a rag to try and dry the commutator off. Give the back part of the shaft the same benefit. Come in with this. Now maybe when it goes all the way together this time, it's going to work properly. None of that sputtering and bogging down after the brushes kick out before it starts running normally again. Someone had commented on one of the Facebook groups about why these motors are considered desirable. It's hard to explain to someone who doesn't care about antique stuff why this would be considered desirable. It's very difficult to explain. But a lot of companies, even back in this day, they were designing things and building them, and what it looked like was purely a function of what the parts needed to do to work. In other words, you needed an end of a motor, a round circle with a round bushing in it was enough. But for this company, it took the extra time and effort and money to make it decorative, have these decorative openings in it and have the name cast in it. That's just one example of why this type of motor would be more valuable than one that's plain looking. Okay, let's hook up the test cord again and see what happens. And just like before, the two topmost wires are going to be tied together. Remember, the two black clips go back to the same part of the circuit. And then the two bottom ones also be tied together. Plug it into the switch box here. Free rotation of the shaft. Now here we go for a start. Started a lot better, but that motor definitely has more vibration in it than most of these types. I'm going to get a pad to set it on so it won't move around like that. Now, I don't know if that's going to really help or not, but we're going to find out. Nothing touching, I'll go for another start. Well, I'll tell you what, it does more than hums now, so I think I can take this tag off of there and get rid of that, because I think it's earned having that tag removed. Now, there's some other stuff about this thing that can make it hum but not start. This screw in the slider part right here, that's what sets the rotation direction. And there should be a little notch right in the side of this right here. And a pointer, and if I, maybe I loosen it more. So it's that should let me rotate the brush holder, but yeah, there it goes a little bit. It's just real stiff. There we go. So I can feel a notch there and a notch there, and those are the rotation direction notches. Let's see which way it goes that way. Okay, it's going this way. The top of it's going to the right. So right with that up, the top of it went to the right. Now move it back down to that other position. Now that way the top of it went to the left. Now let's say we by accident we put it right in the middle. So it went to the right. Move it back a little bit. That doesn't work. See that? in that position, it's essentially like a short. So the motor draws a lot of amps, but it doesn't run. And there's probably another position. If this slot had more room to move, there should be a neutral position where it doesn't draw any current and it doesn't run. But I don't think they give it enough freedom of movement for that. Go all the way to the bottom and see what it does. Listen to how long it takes to start. Stop it there. Now I'm going to put it back to its correct position where the notch is. And we'll see how quickly it starts like that. I think it started a lot quicker. So the point I'm trying to make is if somebody has moved that into exactly the wrong spot, the motor won't work. It'll sit there and hum and won't start. And the other thing that people were wondering about is if the polarity on one half of the winding was reversed. So this pair of wires should be one set of windings in the motor. I'm going to go back to resistance mode here, see if you can see it there. So yeah, that's one winding, and then the one that's still hooked up is the other. So I'm going to reverse the connection so that the two windings work against each other. And let's see what it does. You hear that? It just hums. Now if I take these two and take them back off, hook it up the way it was originally, motor works. So the point I made in a Facebook comment, if someone replaced these wires and they didn't pull them back out through the same holes in this little plate, you could have that problem and not know it. So let's try to air compressor start. I'll let that finish. So this is one coil reversed, polarity reversed. Current draw is 3.4 amps on the line when it's like that. Now I'm just going to disconnect one coil. We're going to try to run on half the motor. Current draw is 2.3 amps. It only drew 2.2 amps, but it didn't have any power. So we'll go back to normal running condition. amps running. Now I'm going to disconnect the other half of the winding that was connected earlier. We'll try to run on that half and see what happens. Same thing. Very, very weak. Back to normal. So with this little motor, it looks like if one half of the winding is reversed, you get a hum but no start. If one half the winding is disconnected, it runs, but it has no power. It doesn't have enough power to get up to speed. It also looks like if the brushes have oil residue on them gummed up, it'll hum but not start. And if the forward and reverse brush gear timing adjustment is in exactly the wrong spot, it'll hum but won't start. But when it's like that, it draws a tremendous amount of current. I'm sure that would harm it really quickly. The other scenarios where it doesn't start don't seem to draw much current, so I don't think it would rapidly overheat like that, at least not during troubleshooting. So maybe this will help someone in their troubleshooting efforts in the future.